So, interestingly, I would actually categorize altered carbon in the exact same category as Bright, also from Netflix. Ooh, the plot thickens! This is a very thick series, actually, when it comes to what's going on. It's a sci-fi stew. But back to my original point, the thing is, if you're into this kind of storytelling, you're going to really enjoy this. But if you're not into it, this kind of genre, you know, comic booky storytelling, well, then I would not even bother. Because with Bright, well, I liked it, I gave it a good review, and a lot of people did. I know a lot of people who just could not get through it. So if that happened to you, don't even start with Altered Carbon. It is for a very, very, very specific audience. But since I'm a member of that audience, I really enjoyed the first episode, and this is my review of said episode, and I'm very excited to watch the rest of the season. The world building is top notch, right out of the gate. And also in reference to Bright, this has 10 episodes, and therefore is approximately 10 hours. So whereas Bright was just a single film and didn't really get to delve into its world, we're gonna definitely get to explore it here. And you could tell right away from, again, the first episode that that's gonna be the case, because the pacing, I think, is much better for a story of this nature, okay? All right, so first off, though, I want to tackle the two big controversies surrounding the series. Number one, of course, is whitewashing. And I have to say, to this series' credit, this is probably the most open and honest depiction of diverse souls and white bodies that I've seen yet. I mean, it's still diverse souls and white bodies, right? Because no matter how many non-white supporting characters they throw at us over the course of season one, we still only have a situation where everybody seems to be choosing white bodies if they have a choice, right? And I think we'll only really move past whitewashing when we have a story where a white soul is put into a non-white body, when we see the reverse, right? I mean, speaking of open and honest, this series has, you know, tackled this head on in the media with interviews to, you know, promote the show, and that's commendable too. But for all their talk that they've found a way around it, they haven't. I mean, it's a step in the right direction, but as I said, when you have the only when you have the reverse will we have moved beyond this conversation. All right, so the second controversy is Blade Runner ripoff, which it totally is. And I think it's become quite clear at this point that thanks to significant advancements in VFX, anyone can do live-action Blade Runner production design. And while it's mighty impressive here, as it is everywhere else that we've seen it recently, there's just too much of it, and Hollywood needs to find a new trend stat. Okay, so now that we've covered the two controversies, let's talk about the show itself. Like I said, the world building is very, very, very good, from not only what's conveyed in the production design, but also in the script. For instance, sleeving is neatly explored in the prison sequence early on, where prisoners who are being released get re-sleeved in whatever's available. And they explore that, you know, very quickly too, very economically in terms of time, in a shocking, clever, and telling way. Oh, it was really good. I don't want to give it away. And it was subtle too. I appreciated it, but not so subtle that it was lost on you. You know, even if you were, let's say, I was paying close attention, but even if you were casually watching this, you would get it. Tons of questions are thrown at us right away, but it seems to be with purpose, right? Like, by the end of the season, we'll actually have some answers. And we'll see if that's the case, but at least out of the gate, again, that's how it seems. And I'm genuinely interested in getting those answers, which is also important. I'm also really enjoying the acting. Recently, Joel Kinnaman was talking, you know, he's promoting this, and of course people were asking him about Suicide Squad 2. And they were like, oh, what's gonna happen? And my thought wasn't what Joel Kinnaman had to say to that question, but I was like, why on earth would you bring Joel Kinnaman back for Suicide Squad 2? He was so bad in the first film. But here, it was so nice to be reminded that he really can be a good actor. And so I actually feel bad for him. And like, I was watching this and I was like, why were you so bad in Suicide Squad 2? And I still can't quite figure it out. But all I can say is that this is as good as I've... Well, he was very good in House of Cards. And he was, of course, was quite good in The Killing. And I think this is in line more with those than Suicide Squad. And I have to say, to his credit, he is as respectful and faithful as he can be playing someone with an Asian soul. Okay, all right, so it's still really bad to say. But I think he does, like, for instance, a much better job than Scarlett Johansson. So Martha Higareda has a role that could easily be cliche, but she makes it seem quite real. And her partner, played by Waleed Zuaiter is also very likable. I liked them quite a bit. They had a nice dynamic. They seemed like partners. And Chris Connor as Poe, the AI concierge at an Edgar Allan Poe-themed pleasure hotel, brilliant. I hope we see a lot more of him. Byron Mann also makes a strong impression in flashbacks, but apparently he's not the original Kovacs. We probably won't be seeing him again, maybe? I'm not sure. I mean, they teased someone else going forward, and I know from a lot of the press that it's going to be somebody else. And so this just seems weird and somewhat pointless to me. It's like, so he's had an Asian sleeve up until now? This is, you know, you're really going to have to work hard to make this seem okay. And I'd like to comment on more actors of color in the series, but besides our two detectives and Mr. Mann, they don't really get enough screen time, at least in the first episode. Now, speaking of appearance, it is weird to think of having people in your life who aren't defined by their appearance, right? Like, can you see a soul? Can you perceive a person in that way? And how much does what someone look like define them to you? These are really interesting questions that I'm still trying to wrap my head around, quite frankly. I don't know the answers to them, and I'm interested to see them explored further as the series, well, season one progresses. I mean, think about that. That trade, what you look like for immortality, is it really still you in some ways? I find it fascinating. And then finally, while Laeta Kalogridis has been working in Hollywood for quite some time and has delivered some real clunkers during that time, at least as the creator and showrunner here and writer of episode one, she's off to an excellent start. Many of the lines, while very well delivered, are also very well written. Because, you know, she was a big red flag for me with this series because, again, she's done so much stuff that I think is subpar. But here, you know, I have to give credit where credit is due. She's doing, at least, again, with episode one, a very impressive job. And you know what else is interesting to me? It's interesting to see this niche genre of storytelling get such an expensive upgrade. Talk about being re-sleeved, right? Although it very much looks the same, so it's not the same situation. But you used to be able to only read these kinds of stories or watch them in anime from Asia. To see them in the Western mainstream with so much money being spent on them. So much money! Wow, Netflix! I mean, this could be an excellent path for Netflix to kind of be like this visual comic book store where we can get these types of stories that are respectfully and expensively told. I'm having a good time, and Bright so far has worked out quite nicely for the streamer. So let's see, again, if this is not only a path that fans praise, but is good for Netflix's bottom line. You know, for some reason, these things don't find an audience when they're on the big screen, maybe because they're free, you know, included with the subscription price. People, you know, it's a little bit more palatable to that audience. I'm not sure what the change is, right? Why these movies don't succeed on the big screen. I mean, maybe Blade Runner 2049 should have been on Netflix. Maybe it would have done a lot better. Maybe it should have been a series. But it's an interesting development. All right, so that's my review of episode one. I'm curious to hear your thoughts about it down below on the controversies, on the writing, on the world building, on the acting. So much to talk about. And also the thoughts on appearance and how much that factors into defining a person. There's a lot to discuss. So I look forward to continuing that with you down below. If you've gone beyond episode one, don't give any spoilers away. Save those for the full season review. And as always, you can check out some more videos right now.